Hello everyone. So today we are going to discuss about Anderson bridge. Already those who have studied about AC bridges, they know that this is the most important one when we are considering the AC bridges which can measure self inductance. The reason is that the structure of this bridge is something different from rest of the other bridges. So what are the differences we can find? That is, normally you can find the detector is connected between this point, that is B point, to D point, but here the detector is connected between B to O. So this area is something new which we can find in this particular bridge. So by this bridge, what we can measure? We can measure the self inductance. Basically, the measurement is very precise one. You can find it is written here. For the precise measurement of self inductance, this particular bridge is used. And second thing is that the range of the measurement of this bridge is really very high. So these are the two major advantages. That is why this particular bridge is important. Point number three that we need to remember is that it is basically a modification of our Maxwell inductance capacitance bridge. So here you can find the unknown inductance should be measured with the help of a standard capacitor. Remember, this capacitor is not a variable one, whereas this small r, this resistance, is basically a variable one. This is a variable one. So here the excitation is basically capital E, which is a AC in nature, given to the system, due to which I1 and I2 are the two branch currents flowing through the two different branches, and due to which each branch produces a certain amount of voltage drop, that is E1, E2, E3 and E4. But remember, just like any other bridges, we cannot write here E1 is equal to E2, because E2 does not represent the voltage drop of this total branch up to O. That means E2 does not represent the voltage drop from A to O. So that is why the calculations will be something different, and that is why it is very important for the exam. So from this diagram, we can find that the voltage drop of this branch, that is branch 3, should be is equal to voltage drop across this capacitor, because the potential of B and O are same. That means potential difference between B and O is basically zero. So our first iteration could be like that: I1 into R3 is equal to IC into C. What is IC? The current which is flowing through this particular branch, that is from D point to C point via O. Now IC is the current flowing through the capacitor will create a voltage drop, that is basically IC into 1 by j omega C. So this one will be IC into 1 by j omega C. Or we can write IC, that is the capacitor current, is equal to I1 into R3 into j omega C. This is equation number 1. Now we can find that the voltage drop across this branch, that is branch 1, is E1. Now let me introduce what is L1 and R1. L1 is the unknown self inductance that we want to measure. R1 is the resistive part of that particular inductor, and small R1 is basically a non-inductive resistor connected in series with the inductor. So the voltage drop across this branch is E1, which should be is equal to voltage drop across this branch which contains R2, that is E2, plus the voltage drop across this small R, which is a variable resistor, and normally this resistor is used for balancing this particular bridge. So the voltage drop between A to B is equal to voltage drop between A to O via D. So we can write here voltage drop between A and B point is current I1 multiplied by the impedance of the branch, that is small R1 plus capital R1 plus j omega L1. That is the impedance of this branch. Now the voltage drop across this branch, that is A 2O path should be is equal to branch current I2 multiplied with the resistance that is R2 and the voltage drop of this branch that is IC into small r. IC into small r. Now from the equation 1, we know the value of IC is this one. So we will put that value here. So or we can write down I1 R1 capital R1 J omega L1 should be is equal to I2 into R2 plus IC. The value of IC is I1 R3 J omega C into small r. So you can find if I replace IC with the value of the equation 1, then we will get an equation which contains only I1 and I2. No other currents are available here. So put this equation as equation number A. Now, whatever another thing we can find here is that the voltage drop across this branch 4, that is IR into R4, should be equal to the voltage drop across this path. That means voltage drop between D to C is equal to D to C via O, this branch. So voltage drop of this branch is equal to voltage drop across this particular branch. So from that we can write that this is another condition. Remember, we need to put this kind of conditions here to solve this equation, because we need to find out two unknown parameters L1 and R1. For that we need at least two equations. So I4 into R4 is equal to IC into small r plus the voltage drop across the capacitor, that is IC into 1 by j omega C. Now put the value of IC here, that will be IR into R4. The value of IC is I1 R3 j omega C. So I am putting it here directly, I1 R3 j omega C R. Now j omega C will be cancelled out. So it will be I1 into R3. So this is equation number B. So now you can find equation A contains only two branch currents I1, I2. Equation B also contains I1 and R4. Okay, so we need to replace I4 also. So I4 is equal to, we can find I4 is equal to the incoming current I2 minus of IC. So we can write as I2 is equal to I4 plus IC. So we can write equation number B in this form, that is I2 minus IC into R4 is equal to I1 R3 j omega C into R plus I1 R3. Put the value of IC here, then it will be I2 into R4 minus I1 R3 j omega C R4 is equal to I1 R3 j omega C smaller plus I1 into R3. So right now you can find the equation number B has been converted into an equation which contains only two branch current, that is I1 and I2. So now rearranging this equation, we can write down, take I1 as common, then it will be R3 plus R3 j omega C into R plus R3 j omega C into R4 is equal to I2 into R4. This is equation number 2. So from equation number B, we have come down to equation number 2. Now take the equation 1. So hopefully you can find whatever I have written till now. it is visible here. Now from equation number A, what we can write down, take I1 as common, then it will be small r1 capital R1 j omega L1 minus r3 j omega C into R is equal to I2 into R2. Or I1 into R1 plus small r1 plus j omega L1 minus R3 j omega CR is equal to I2. From equation number 2, we can put the value of I2. What is the value of I2? This whole thing divided by R4 is equal to I2. So take that value. So it will be I1 into R3 plus R3 j omega CR plus R3 j omega C R4. So R2 is here, so it will be multiplied by R2. This R4 should come here. These R4 should come here, so it will be multiplied here. So I have done nothing. I have basically used equation number 2 in this equation, that is equation number A. What I have done? This is the value of I2. I have replaced this I2 with the equation number 2. My equation number 2 gives me this whole thing divided by R4 is equal to I2. So put that value multiplied by this R2, and this R4 which is here should be multiplied here. So I1 is now cancelled out. I have right now only one equation. So from this equation we can calculate the value of L1 and R1. So let's find out how to do that one. So simply do the multiplication R4 R1, then R1 into R4, then R4 j omega L1 minus R4 R3 j omega CR is equal to R2 R3 R2 R3 j omega C into R plus R2 R3 j omega C R4 R2 R3 j omega C R4. Now you can find this is the equation which contains some real parts plus some imaginary part. So this is the final equation that we normally get in the previous cases by using the concept of Z1, Z4 is equal to Z2, Z3. So to find out this equation, we need to do this whole calculations. Now, from real parts. So equating the real parts from real parts, what we can find? R4 R1 plus R1 R4 is equal to R2 R3. What is the unknown parameter here? That is R1. So the value of R1 is equal to R2 R3 divided by R4 minus of R1. So this is the unknown resistive part of the inductor that we want to measure, right? Now, from imaginary part, that is equating the imaginary part of left hand side and right hand side is equal to zero, then we can write down this one. So hopefully you can find the whole equation here. Let me give you an overview of this equation. So the first imaginary part is this one, that is I'm writing it here, R4 j omega L1 minus R4 R3 जे ओमेगा सी आर इज इक्वल टू आर टू आर थ्री जे ओमेगा सी इन टू आर प्लस आर टू आर थ्री जे ओमेगा सी इन टू आर फोर. सो वी कैन फाइंड इन एवरी टर्म्स जे ओमेगा इज देयर, सो वी कैन कैंसिल आउट दैट वन. सो इट विल बिकम आर फोर एल वन शुड बी इज इक्वल टू आर टू आर थ्री सी इन टू आर प्लस आर टू आर थ्री आर फोर सी प्लस आर फोर आर थ्री सी आर. सो और एल वन शुड बी इज इक्वल टू what we can take common from here, that you can find R3 is everywhere and C is there. So then it will become C into R3 divided by R4. So it will become like this one, C R3, if it gone, then it will be R2 into R, R2 R4, R2 R4 R4 small r, or we can write this one C R3 by R4, then take small r common, then it will be R2 plus R4 R2 into R4. L1 is equal to. So this is the value of unknown inductance that we have calculated from this Anderson bridge. So now if you check the book of that is A.K. Sahani, then you can find the equations are like this one. So that is all for today. So hopefully you can find it everything. Now in the next video, we'll try to explain the phasor diagram of this same topic, that is the phasor diagram of Anderson bridge. Till then, thank you.